Hi, this is Steve Michelotti of the Azure Government Engineering team. I'm joined here today by my colleague, Yujin Hong, also on the Azure Government Engineering team. Welcome, Yujin.
Hi, Steve.
So we're here today to talk about machine learning on Azure Government. I feel like this is a question that comes up a lot for us. So why don't you start out by giving us some options? What are the options we have available for ML on Azure Gov today?
That's a great question. So one of our VM offerings is actually the Data Science Virtual Machine, which pretty much comes preloaded with all of the frameworks and tools that one might need for data science. Things like Spark, TensorFlow, SQL Server, as well as Power BI. Another VM offering that we actually have is ML Server, which actually you can actually go through the whole machine learning and deep learning pipeline all on that one VM.
Okay, so when you say VM offering, these are things that we just install on a straight on a virtual machine, and you can spin them up anywhere.
You just click deploy, and they're ready to use right away.
Okay, all right, cool.
And we actually have Azure Databricks coming to Azure Gov by the end of this year.
Okay.
So that's something to look forward to, as well as HDInsight,
okay,
which I'm actually going to be showcasing in my demo today.
Okay, great. So HDInsight. So what is HDInsight? Can you give us a little bit more information about that?
Right. So HDInsight is actually a fully managed Azure service that pretty much deploys and provisions Apache Hadoop clusters into the Azure cloud. So what this really means is users can customize and control their clusters. So they have a bunch of open source offerings such as Hive, Pig, Hadoop, as well as Spark that they can choose when they're deploying their cluster, as well as scaling. So if you have a large data set, you might want to have more nodes or cores on your cluster. So you can easily configure and customize that when you're deploying.
Ah, so you're saying I can say, give me a 100 node cluster, or maybe I only need 10 nodes.
Exactly.
Or give me 100, but then I'm done, blow them away.
Right. So that's a great part of it, is that you can save a lot of money by just deleting your cluster after you're done and spinning up a new one when you want to use another.
Awesome. Okay. So how do I get started with machine learning using HDInsight? I heard you mention some things like Spark. Tell me more about that.
Right. So I'm actually going to kind of focus on Spark today because that is what I'm going to be using in my demo. So the great thing about Spark is it operates on the power of resilient distributed datasets, or RDDs. So what this means is if you have a large dataset, you can distribute that evenly across worker nodes. So these are the RDD data structures. So you can perform transformations and queries in parallel. So that allows for much faster processing, especially if you're working with large datasets. It also supports in-memory caching. So as you're kind of going through the transformations and queries, as you're going through like a machine learning pipeline, that saves in memory.
Okay, so is Spark some kind of Microsoft creation?
Actually, no. Spark is owned by Apache. It was actually created by students at UC Berkeley.
Okay.
So it's an open source framework, and HDInsight just happens to support it.
Okay, so for anyone that's ever had to provision a Spark cluster before manually, it's a pain.
Yes.
And with HDInsight, click a few buttons, boom, there's your cluster.
Exactly, exactly.
Okay, makes sense. So what does the ML process look like?
So I have a kind of helpful little diagram over here that I'm going to be referring to in my demo as well. So this is kind of a basic pipeline. Some data scientists might not use this. This really depends on the type of data that you have. But these are usually the steps that you go through. So first is data acquisition. The data is the most important part. You can load that into Azure Storage. Then you want to pre-process the data. So that can mean filtering for null values and only narrowing down your data set to categories that you're interested in. And then data exploration is kind of an ongoing cycle, as you can see from the diagram, because as you're going through and filtering and cleaning your data, you're going to learn more about it, and you're going to kind of see the patterns between the variables. And that will help you clean your data more effectively.
Makes sense. So it's sort of an iterative process,
yes,
so to speak. Okay.
Yes. Most data scientists, from my knowledge, go through the process more than once.
Yeah.
And then once you have a cleaned data set, you can train a model on that data set. So actually, which I'm going to show you, Spark comes with a bunch of algorithms that are already pre-built. So, but you can write one from scratch as well.
Okay.
You can train that model on your test data set. Then you want to test your model. So you usually have your training data set and a test data set. So once you train your model, you can test it and get an accuracy. And then once you're happy with, you have a high accuracy, you're happy, you want to save your model, and you can deploy your model. So deploying your model could mean wrapping it up into a container and accessing it through a web app or an API call, as well as using the Libby service, which is a REST API-based service. Basically, you're making API calls directly to a Spark cluster.
So Libby is some native API, native to Spark.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So I also heard you talk about Docker, which is interesting. So I could containerize my model and deploy it anywhere I wanted, really. I could, doesn't even have to be in Azure. I could train using big Azure in some massive 1,000 node cluster, but deploy it anywhere.
Exactly.
Okay. Exactly. All right, great. All right, so this is great information. I really like this diagram, keeps it straight. So tell us about the demo.
So just a quick overview of what we're going to be looking at. The data, we're actually looking at two different data sets. So we have a flight data set and a corresponding weather data set. The flight data set is actually from the Bureau of Transportation. The recording variables such as airport, carrier, total number of flights, and the delays for each of those variables. And we have corresponding weather data, which would be like humidity and temperature. So the purpose of this demo will be to predict how likely it is for a flight to be delayed based on all these variables that I just mentioned. So the process is kind of loading the data from Azure Storage Account or wherever you have your data stored into your Jupyter Notebook on your HDInsight cluster.
Okay.
And then here you do all the data processing and you actually go through the machine learning pipeline, you spit out a model, and you can save that model right back to Azure Storage.
Okay, so I hear you describing kind of that diagram on the last slide.
Exactly.
All right, cool.
All right, so here we have our Jupyter Notebook. This is actually running on a Spark HDInsight cluster right now. So we're predicting flight delay. I'm actually going to bring in the same diagram that we had before. So as we go through this notebook, we are going to hit each of these steps. So first step, data acquisition, as you can see from the highlighted orange. So the great thing about HDInsight is that it has seamless integration with Azure Storage. So I actually have my data loaded into my Azure Blob Storage account.
So that's that WASB weird looking thing, right?
Exactly,
there.
Okay. Yes. That's a direct address to my data.
Okay.
So this sc.txt file, this line of code right here, is actually just bringing in that data into my Jupyter Notebook as an RDD, which is the data structure that Spark works with.
Okay.
So now we can see here's the actual raw data. We know that we've loaded it incorrectly. However, if you look at it, it's kind of hard to look at. It's very unstructured, which is, well, most raw data is not going to be super pretty when you first load it in.
Gotcha. And you have on line 9 there, just take 3, meaning show me the first 3 records,
exactly,
just so I can get an idea. We know it's a lot bigger than that, but just show me the beginning. Okay,
great. And there's other helpful methods like count, just to make sure you have the right number of rows. So that actually leads us to our next step, because we want to transform this raw data into something we can work with. So the next step is data pre-processing. So it really depends on what kind of data set and what models you want to train your data on. But the steps that I decided to take was first cleaning the data and then building a data frame. So data frame is like a SQL table. You have the categories. It's a structured data set, so it's much easier to work with. So here are some of the categories that we really want to look at. So as I mentioned before, we are working with 2 different data sets. I'm going to go through all of the different steps on each of the data sets separately and then at the end merge them together. So here we're starting with our airline data set. We want to look at the categories such as year, the date, the time, the originating airport of the flight, and then the destination airport, total number of flights, things like carrier, and the actual delay.
Okay.
So
it's a whole bunch of data we have here.
Yes. So here is actually a schema that you can print out of your raw data. And as we can see, there's a lot of different columns. The types are kind of different. There's integers, there's doubles, there's strings. So what I first did was filtering the data for null values and converted types into the data frame that I wanted.
So when we talk about that pre-processing, it's the janitorial aspects. We're cleaning it up.
Yes.
So it's, in this case, your example is removing the null values or the data types. Could be anything, but these are just the examples from yours.
Exactly.
Okay, makes sense.
And as you can see from the screen, it's actually just Python code. So what I did was I defined a custom Python function, and I can still use the power of RDDs in Spark by mapping. So this line of code right here is where I'm actually mapping the custom function that I just defined onto my RDD, or the data set that I brought.
Okay, so those cleanup functions for removing null values, that's happening on 115, right?
Right.
Okay, cool.
So it's just showing that you can just write freeform Python code.
Great.
Write your own functions. So this step is where I'm actually going to construct the data frame. So this block of code is where I'm defining, here are the different categories that I want, here are the different types I want them to be, and then I'm going to map, I'm with this dot create data frame line of code right here, I am just mapping this construct that I defined onto that raw data set.
Okay, so more cleanup stuff.
Yes.
All right, cool.
So here is kind of a nicer view of that data. So that's the power of data frames. And I kind of went through the same steps for the weather data, so I'm going to skip it. I do want to kind of talk about the different aspects of the weather data set. So there's like wind speed, humidity, Celsius, and the same date and the airport. So that's how we're going to merge the two data sets together. So same thing, filtering the data. Here I am going to do a grouping the weather data by the date and the airport, because that's the kind of format and aggregation we need of the data. So here you can see it's just a SQL query, right? And so I can just write freeform SQL queries and still use the power of Spark, and Spark can still perform those SQL queries on my data.
I see, so it's interesting. So if I'm more comfortable with SQL, I can do that, but if I like the Spark syntax with Python, I can do that. Either are okay.
Exactly.
All right, makes sense. All right,
exactly.
Cool. Let's keep going.
So there's my weather data frame. All right, so now we are kind of at the data exploration step. So now we are just going to kind of plot the different relationships between the variables and the number of delays. So for here, we try to see how many carriers have the highest number of delays, airports, same thing. And actually, I wanted to plot, there are a lot of airports with less than 100 flights, so I wanted to kind of filter out that noise and to improve the accuracy of my model later on. So now I'm actually kind of going back to the pre-processing. So here's an example of that iterative process. So I'm going to clean my weather data set. Now that I know that I want to filter out some of that noise, I'm going to go ahead and do that.
So this already does look like the iterative process. We acquire the data, we pre-process it. As we explore it, we might decide we want to do some more pre-processing.
Exactly,
okay.
So now that we've gone through that step, we want to merge the data sets, like I said before, which is what this SQL statement is doing here. And then now I have this joined data set. I've cleaned everything. I've gone through the pre-processing. Now I'm ready for the next step,
Okay. Just
training the model. So there's a couple steps involved before you can actually run the algorithm on your data. So you need to split the training and the testing data, like I mentioned before, which is what I did here. Usually your training data set is larger.
So then, it might be a case where you're training on 75% of your data and
Yes. Testing
on 25, remaining 25%.
Yes.
Okay.
And then you want to actually restructure the data in order to create feature vectors. So feature vectors is just the format that your data needs to be in for the algorithm to process it and actually
Right. Train
on it. So features would be kind of like the variables that I mentioned, the time, the airports, the carriers, the weather, and you end up with a label for that feature vector. So the label would be, hey, one, there is a delay, zero, there isn't a delay. So this pipeline that I defined over here, I kind of wanted to pause at this because I wanted to talk about pipelines. So pipelines is this really cool feature that's included in Spark. Basically allows you to define different stages in this line of code right here. We can see there's all these stages that I defined, right? And what I'm going to do is with this one line of code where I just fit my data into this pipeline, it's going to go through each of those stages.
Okay.
So it just kind of reduces that
hassle. So fit is the magic line of code where it train
Yes. Model.
Okay.
Exactly. So now I'm actually going to train the model, run the machine learning algorithm. Before, that was just creating the feature vectors. So same thing, I'm actually going to have a pipeline as well. So this is the magic line of code where I'm actually pulling in a pre-built model. So I'm going to use a logistic regression model. This is all pre-built, comes with PySpark machine learning library.
All right, logistic regression, that sounds complicated. Did you have to write that all yourself?
No, this one line of code right here is all I had to do. So I just had to give it, here's my features column, the name of the features column, and then I can give it some parameters, and then right away I can just run it through this pipeline.
So some data scientists will write logistic regression, and then we can just pull that into our code.
Exactly.
All right, cool.
Exactly. And you can feel free to tweak it and write your own algorithms.
Yep.
That's completely fine. But these have been proven to have a high accuracies.
Yep.
So now that I've actually fit my model and I have machine learning model now, I want to test it. So this is kind of the same magic. You can just bring in a machine learning library already comes with these classification metrics, which kind of gives you the accuracy. And I mean, you could go through and map, hey, was how many of these predictions were true, and then divide by 100 and get your accuracy. But this is just a lot cleaner. So we have our accuracy right over here. And now that brings us to our last step, deploying the model. And I just did want to mention, I did only train on one logistic regression model, but there are so many others that you can bring in for binary classification as well as multi-classification.
I see. So not only can we iterate on the data cleansing process, but we can even iterate on training the model, trying different things out.
Exactly.
Sometimes I think we think of machine learning as this magic wand, but a lot of times it's just some trial and error getting things right.
It is. There's been times when I've ran through like 6 or 7 different algorithms to get a high accuracy.
All right, cool.
Yeah. So now we're at our last step, deploying the model. So as I mentioned before when I was going through the slides, deploying the model could mean you wrap it up in a container. Now that we have that model that I just said, we first need to actually save it. So it's this one magic line of code right here. You're saving that whole pipeline.
Okay.
And you save it directly back to your Azure storage. As you can see, it's that same address right here.
Yep.
And then you can load it back in with another one line of code.
So we could run it in Livy, or if we want, we could deploy it to a container.
Or you can open it in another Jupyter notebook in a different cluster, right?
Okay, awesome.
Yeah.
All right, well, this has been a great discussion on machine learning in Azure Government with HDInsight. This is Steve Michelotti from the Azure Government Engineering team with Yujin Hong talking about machine learning on Azure Government. Thanks for watching.